Thank you so much. We have been traditionally thinking that third now Parsis are third now Parsis and they don't cross borders, cross swords with the CCDDs. I just want to show some cases with lot of evident sort of disinnervation to show that third now Parsis we should also look at as CCDDs. And I said earlier about 20-25% of the cases of the third now Parsis have been shown to have hypoplastic oculomotor nerve. So these are not that they are going to come into the CCDD basket. Now this is, I'll be showing three patients. These all three have been published. Now this is an 8-year-old boy presented with poor vision and outward deviation of the right eye since birth. As you can see, this looks like right third now palsy. He has got exotropia of 70 prism diopters and hypotropia of about 20. There is, you can see slight head tilt to the right. And there was no gross restriction to the elevation on FDT in this eye. Now this is showing the, if you can look at the, if you can see the motility, there is hypotropia. And as in the side gazes, as he goes to the left gaze, the right, there is a synergistic divergence. The eye is diverging and probably slightly going up in this, in the side gazes. And as the child is looking up, the right eye is not elevating, but it is adducting. So what classically is seen in, say, CFM or third nerve palsies because of aberrant innervation, there is an ESO in up gaze. And of course, the eye is not moving much. If you look at in the down gaze also, the eye is not moving. So it is not like CFM because eye should have been fixed in down gaze, which is not there. It is not moving much in down gaze also. And when he looks into the this thing, right side, the other eye goes, diverges and goes up also. So there is vertical as well as horizontal divergence, which can be seen in this child. I'll be showing a video also and on tilt, it doesn't come as positive. Now this is a small video just to show the nystagmus and divergence. Now there was no nystagmus in the primary position, but as he looks this side, there is a jerk nystagmus beating to this thing right side. And when he look this, now look at, look here, now this eye is going up and that eye is going down. There is a torsional nystagmus in the right eye, which is there. So he had both jerk pendular nystagmus in the left eye and a torsional nystagmus in the right eye. The right eye nystagmus could be because of the INC involvement, and the left could be because of the vestibular nuclei involvement. That is my conjecture, of course, because there is no way to be very decisive. Now this is showing, you can see that there is intorsion in the right eye and left eye torsion is normal. Now intorsion in right eye, one may say that this is because of the fourth nerve intact, fourth nerve, one may reason that. But now look at what happens when the child is trying to look up, because in this case we could take a photograph because the eye is not actually elevating. And you see that this right eye has it has gone into long, very severe extorsion, and the left eye has intorted. So this only happens, this is classical conjugate torsion, which we see in ocular tilt reaction. So this is something like a phasic conjugate torsion, which I think has not been described in literature, which we saw in this patient, that show that there is involvement of the otolithic pathways along with the third nerve nucleus. And the synergistic divergence could be because of the involvement of the at the level of the sixth nerve. So you have that kind of synergistic divergence also. Now, are we dealing with the pupillary third nerve or it is CFM 3? Now, for the third nerve, we have a fellow eye is affected. There is a gaze evoked nystagmus, as I showed you, that there is a torsional nystagmus in the right eye. And there is also a vestibular, central vestibular nystagmus in the left eye, though in PP it was not there. Normally the vestibular nystagmus is also there in primary position, but here it was not seen. And there is disinnervation and aberrant innervation in, and there was also right MR hypoplasia on MRI. There is synergistic divergence and conjugate gaze evoked torsion. Now these features are in addition to the third nerve palsy. So once you, in this kind of presentation, tells us that these third nerve palsies could be CCDD rather just third nerve palsy. Now this gaze evoked nystagmus, as I said, this is because of the conjugate torsion, because of the ocular tilt reaction, what we classically see there. Now these are the gravisceptive pathways. I don't want to go into detail. The vestibular nuclei, and as it is crossing to the other side, so the third nerve on the right side and probably the vestibular nuclei on the left side, something, some problem might be there. We can't say. On MRI, we got only MR hypoplasia. Our MRI was not very good, I think. They didn't catch any other finding. Even third nerve, they could not catch, unfortunately. Now, nystagmus, as I said, this could be vertical because of INC involvement in the torsional nystagmus in the right eye, and the horizontal jerk nystagmus because of the involvement of the vestibular nuclei, the central vestibular nystagmus, maybe, likely. This is just showing the areas which could be affected from the vestibular nuclei till the INC, and the third nerve and the fourth nerve are on the way. They are neighbors, they are lying close together, so they can be affected by each other. So, and the SD was because of the involvement of the sixth and third nerve, likely somewhere. So, it is a very complex presentation that way. And he also had cryptorchidism and renal aplasia, which was again interesting because this had also systemic connotations in the form of renal aplasia, which is seen with acroadenal syndromes, Okihiro, Holt-Oram, DURS, and PAX2 and SALFOR mutations. So, we don't know the genetic part, we could not do. So this was a novel presentation, which was a third nerve with a lot of CNS involvement. Now this is another child, which we can see here that this eye is, there is a lid retraction and the eye is almost nailed into abduction. Now when the child is looking to the, in fact this picture is getting cut because of this display. Now as he's looking to the opposite side, there is a synaptic divergence and this eye is going a bit, if you can see, it's going down. In that child, the eye was going up. In this child, the right eye is going down. Both are right eyes affected. And this one, the eye is going down along with this synergistic divergence. Now, this is a small video which will show that with the, there is a MGP which is linked to the, there is eye goes in when he opens his jaw. And once he moves sideways, there is activation of the medial rectus. So with what we see in Marcus gun, and now see here, this eye is dipped down much and there is a synaptic divergence. So these are the features which are very atypical in this patient. And this also tells us that this was also a third nerve. And this is third one, which was published in the archives. This was a left side control third nerve with pupillary involvement. Those two did not involve pupil. This one had pupillary involvement also. And when she presses over her eye, you will see that the lid elevates. There is no change in the ocular movements, but there is elevation of the lid. And this remains for about 1 minute or so. And then see, the lid has elevated without any effort. And there is no improvement in the motility. Now this will remain for about 40 seconds or so, and then this is going to again fall back, and then once she does it again, this again happens. So this can only be explained by, there is a mollis muscle which is known to act like spindle for the LPS. So either this is yoke to the fifth nerve as proprioception going to the mesencephalic nucleus of the fifth nerve, and there is some innervation to the LPS, or it is through the mollis, the sympathetic system, that this is the LPS is being fired, because it is, the LPS cannot be fired by just touch. Now she'll just touch again and you will see that again, this has taken about 30-40 seconds and the lid has dropped again. Now when she touches again, she will again have that. I think we can show. I think we are running short of time and this video is about 2 minutes. Yeah.
It's totally fine, Dr. Pramod. We are very good in time.
So we are in time. So this again, she does that and you can see that lid elevates almost to normal. And there is very little blinking in her. The other eye doesn't blink, you know. This is again something peculiar. And there is no change in the motility and no pupillary change. Only the lid is affected. So that means only LPS is firing because of either mollis spindle effect, or it is because of the fifth nerve innervation, which is going to the mesencephalic nucleus in the midbrain. We don't know. We published this in archives in 2010. And this is three cases I have shown which show that the third nerve pulses can have a lot of disinnervation, and they should, we should look at them in a slightly, I mean, we should look at them differently. We should also think of, and third nerve pulses have also been shown to have a lot of systemic associations, vital third nerve pulses. So it's not that they are always isolated. So MRI, maybe some cases you may find a lot of interesting findings. So one should keep that in mind, that if there's a third nerve, you could also have a CCDD. Now, carry home message that there is more to third nerve pulses than meets the eye. Think of a CCDD while evaluating third nerve pulses.